soup downstairs. It's really good. I think it's corn chowder. It's really good. You know, next year's going to be your 20th year of doing soup luncheons. Kelly and I have had a big party about it. And we've decided you're doing great. There's so many good things about the church, about all that you're doing here at 4th Avenue for the community, for the church, and for mission. We've got an announcement about one of those great projects that's happening right here within your facility that's going to go into the nation to help children. Carolyn of the UMW is going to come and speak to that now, a special report.
Going to do the sewing at home, and we'll have packets made up and put in the coat room across from the parlor. So if people can sew, that would be good. But we're also looking for people who have, you know, like crafters like me, who, oh, I'm going to make that someday, and you didn't do it. So you have fabric sitting around. So we're looking for fabric to put for our pockets. Florals, bright colors, stripes, gingham, whatever you might have. See me if you have some of that after your service. And I guess I'll just say thank you to Dorothy for doing our organization for our cutting. She knew what to do, and she got it going, and we were very thankful for her to have come over from Northfield to help us there, so thank you.
Wow, that's great. Great food, you're in a great community, great mission that you're doing. I can hardly wait for Pastor Greg to get here that last Sunday of June. He's a go-getter. I don't know him personally, but everything I hear about him, you better have your running shoes on. You're going to have to keep up to that young man. He's 51, I believe, or two, and he wants to be here until he retires, and that's a wonderful goal. And he wants to work with you. He wants to come to love you, and you're going to have to keep up. He's great. But you're already on a great roll, on a great roll. We gather together today. It's Mother's Day, but we also celebrate the festival of the Christian home. So we remember moms, but we remember, too, the sanctity of the Christian home. Beloved, I greet you this day in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We'll share together in these words that call us to worship, as we want to remember in these words that God never fails us. I was glad when it was said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord.
Let us hear what the Lord will speak, for we know God
Peace, peace, to the far and to the near, says the Lord.
Blessed are all those who bring peace to the land of Israel.
And to this God, who never failed me yet.
Thank you. just a thank you to Kelly. She's been so great for us all year. She gives us great music to sing and leads us on no matter what. So thank you so much.
Almighty God, our heavenly Creator, who sets peace in families, we commend to your continual care the homes in which your people dwell. Put far from all of us, we ask of you, every root of bitterness, the desire of self-centeredness, and the pride of life. Fill us with faith, good values, knowledge of your holy word, patience, and a sincere desire to worship you. Knit together in constant affection those who have come together in Christian love to serve your kingdom joyously. Turn the hearts of every parent and child so to kindle charity among us all, that we may ever have for each other kindly affection and true love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And if you're able, please stand and we'll sing together, Happy the Home, and God is There. Well, I kind of thought, if a Twizzler represents our family, and we pulled it apart, we have all kinds of types of members of our family. So in that family, we might have mom and dad. That's like two, because they're together. So there's two. And we might have an older brother or sister. They're pretty big, they're kind of like mom and dad. We might have a younger sibling, they might not be quite as big, a little bit shorter. And there might be another one just like that. And then there's grandma and grandpa and aunts and uncles and other nieces and nephews. And all of those get wrapped up and put together into a Twizzler family. So I want you to remember today, because this is Mother's Day, but it's also the festival of the Christian home. In the United Methodist tradition, we need to honor that, to remember that we celebrate families, especially mothers today. You know, you got up and you knew it was Mother's Day, and you have to, you still got a lot of the day left, if you haven't already, say, Happy Mother's Day, Mom. Would you get me something to eat? Something like that. Well, I just wanted to talk to you today about the Twizzler family and to show you that we're made up of all kinds of entities in order to make a good treat like this. And then if you take this Twizzler and you fold it together, you kind of make something that looks like, help me out here, what's that look like? Look at that. A pretzel could be. Yeah, I'm thinking of a heart. Yeah, there you got it. So we tie all those entities up, and you know, some of our family, oh, I like this one, but yeah, that's a little harder to get along with that one. But they're all part of the deal. They all come together like a Twizzler heart. So I just want you to be mindful of that today. On the festival of the Christian home, we honor mothers, but we remember even more that you're a member of the Christian family. You're a part of God's family. Well, as part of that family, I want you to come. Let's see if we can do this. Everybody make a circle. Come on up, make a circle with me. Let's make a big circle. Let's see if we can do this. We're going to have an oblong. Might be a little oblong. Okay, everybody got a right hand? Everybody know which is their right hand? It's this one? Yeah, your right hand. Okay, loose hands here. Raise your right hand. Put it over your left arm. Put it over your left. So it's right over left. There you go. Right over left. Did we get it all? Pretty close. We'll do this another time in June. Maybe you'll catch that then. Okay, there you go. So I'm going to give you a blessing. And this blessing is because we love one another, we know God loves us. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. But we go out into the world and we celebrate life. We celebrate mom today. So let's undo. See how you do. Oh, you did really well. You did really well. Now, I know you're supposed to be going to Sunday school. I have a treat, so you're well sugared for Carrie. Oops. There's one. Who wants the one that I tore apart? Anybody want that one? Maybe the last guy gets that, huh? Here you go. You've got to sing yet. You've got jobs to sing yet. I shouldn't give them that.
Here we go.
We got to start. Here we go. There we go. Thank you, everybody. Okay, now you've got to go up front and sing. women in church today. So you'll get a chance to thank them up close and personal when they come by with your flower. Let's have all the ladies hold your hand up so the kids know to come to you. Go to anyone that has a hand raised. Turn you to the bulletin and the litany for Mother's Day and our unity prayer. And your response as I read each section of this prayer is, we pray to the Lord. And I'll give you a hand signal, and that's how you should respond. We pray to the Lord. For our mothers who have given us life and love, that we may show them reverence and love, we pray to the Lord. For mothers who have lost a child through death, that their faith may give them hope, and their family and friends support and console them.
We pray to the Lord.
For women, though without children of their own, who like mothers have nurtured and cared for us.
We pray to the Lord.
For mothers who have been unable to be a source of strength, who have not responded to their children, and have not sustained their families.
We pray to the Lord.
Loving God, as a mother gives life and nourishment to her children, so you watch over your church. Join with me. Bless all women, that they may be strengthened as Christian mentors. Let the example of their faith and love shine forth. Grant that we, their sons and daughters, may honor them always with a spirit of profound respect. Grant this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And in unity and together, we pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Receive now. Enjoy a blessing in music as our offering is received. Amen.
Dedicate this song to my mom.
I own Oni Corp. And my mother-in-law, Jerry Christensen. So I don't have those mothers anymore, but I'm saying this to all mothers out there today. When I am down, and oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come, and my heart burdened be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. There is no life without its hunger. Each restless heart
each dollar given and each soul who's contributed, for we ask it this blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. We are children of blessing. We are children of promise. Please stand if you are able as we sing together hymn 611.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Two readings of scripture today, very familiar to you, from 1 Peter. Like newborn infants, long for pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable unto God through Jesus Christ. For it is written in the scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you then who believes, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a priesthood royal, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people." And a reading from the Gospel of John in chapter 14. "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. But Thomas said to him, 'Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?' Jesus said to him, 'I am the way,'" you know this, say it with me, "'I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. If you had known me, you would have known that my Father, you would have known my Father also. Henceforth you know him, and you have seen him.' Philip said to him, 'Lord, show us the Father, and we shall be satisfied.' Jesus said to him, 'Have I been with you so long, and you do not know me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I go to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it, and the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
The laying of a cornerstone. A new building, there has to be a cornerstone. It represents the completion of the building of a structure that is intended to stand for a long, long time. The Church of Jesus Christ is one such structure. We ask, well, where is the cornerstone of the church? Raise your hand. Just raise your hand. I'm not going to call on you or ask anything. Just raise your hand. Because the answer to the question I just asked is every one of you who raised a hand. Where is the cornerstone of the church? When you raise your hand, you acknowledge that you are the cornerstone of the church. Each of you who are disciples of Jesus Christ, you are where the cornerstone of the church is placed. In your heart and on your soul. It's for all the world to see. As you go out from this building into the world today, people are going to see you. Will they know that you're a Christian? Will they know that you're a part of the cornerstone of the Church of Jesus Christ? Visitors interested in the history of a church may ask, well, when was this church built? I want to say that it's still under construction. But I know what they mean. What date appears on the cornerstone? And as you exit the building today, you can see the cornerstone. I always want to say that we are as old as the first Christian, but I know they want to know the age of Fourth Avenue, an established congregation since, who knows, 1855. Still though, we give the answers to the questions we know people are really asking. We have to remember that Jesus Christ is the one and the true cornerstone of the church. And that cornerstone is embodied in each one of us. And today we celebrate that cornerstone, that building known as the church, because it represents our family, the festival. The joyous day upon which we remember all mothers, but all Christian families. In Acts, we see Peter remaining steadfast as he faces his accusers and encourages them to turn back to the reality of Christ. He speaks of how the leaders have drifted from God's presence and how Jesus Christ was sent to bring them back. Jesus needs to keep coming. Because we keep going a different route. We go away from the church. Refusing to accept the reality of Jesus Christ was, in effect, refusing to accept the very cornerstone of their salvation, the mark of the very beginning of the journey of their faith. We need to ask ourselves today, where have we missed in the placement of this cornerstone of God in our own lives? Are we completed? No. But there's a cornerstone, an aspect of God's love that's been placed within us. Where is that? How are we using it? How are we being called back to an affirmation of Jesus Christ? Or to shout the amen or the hallelujah. Peter says we are in need of being saved and that salvation comes in the very person of Jesus Christ. Let us renew our own efforts to open our eyes then to the living presence of God and embrace life. Never give up. God never failed me yet. A son meets with his mother, and in his life, he's always known her as being very energetic. She would never give up. And he asked her one day, Mom, how are you feeling? And her answer really surprised him, because she started to give this little litany of aches and pains. Well, my eyes aren't what they used to be. I have to kind of sometimes squint to get my vision. My hearing, sometimes I don't hear what people say. And if I turn my neck, I can't really turn it right or left anymore. And my hands, I can't grab onto anything or hold it anymore. But you know, he remembered she was always so enthusiastic, and she ended her little scenario by saying, but you know, I can still drive the car. That's a little frightening. But she was enthusiastic. We can still drive the soul of this church. We can go into our future and be elevated into the presence of God. In 1 John, we're offered a strong model for living out our faith. In fact, more than a strong model, an exceedingly difficult model to emulate, using us exceedingly. Jesus sets the example for us when John says, "We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another." A hard example to follow. We're not Jesus, but we're Christians who say we're like him. We're like him. God had a hard time making Christians, I think. I know he had a hard time making mothers. By the time the Lord made mothers, he was into the sixth day of working overtime. An angel appeared and said, "Why are you spending so much time on this one?" And the Lord answered and said, "Have you read the spec sheet on her? She has to be completely washable, but not plastic. Have 200 movable parts, all replaceable. Run on black coffee and leftovers. Have a lap that can hold 3 children at one time, but that disappears when she stands up. Have a kiss that can cure anything from a scraped knee to a broken heart, and have 6 pairs of hands." The angel was astonished at the requirement for this one. 6 pairs of hands? No way, said the angel. The Lord replied, "Oh, it's not the hands that are the problem. It's the 3 pairs of eyes that the mother must have." And that's on the standard model. The angel asked, the Lord nodded in agreement. Yep, 1 pair of eyes are to see through the closed door as she asks her children, "What's going on in there?" Even though she already knows. Another pair in the back of her head are to see what she needs to know, even though no one thinks she can. And the 3rd pair are there in the front of her head. They're looking at an errant child and saying that she understands and loves him or her without even saying a single word. The angel tried to stop the Lord. "It's too much for you to do in one day. Wait until tomorrow to finish it." "But I can't," the Lord said. "I'm so close to finishing this creation. She already heals herself when she's sick and can feed a family of 6 on a pound of hamburger and can get a 9-year-old to stand in the shower." The angel moved closer and touched the woman. "But Lord, you've made her so soft." "Well, she is soft," said the Lord, "but I've also made her tough. You have no idea what that one can endure and accomplish." Will she be able to think, asked the Lord. The Lord replied, "Well, not only will she be able to think, she'll be able to reason and negotiate." The angel then noticed something and reached out and touched the woman's cheeks. "Whoops, it looks like you have a leak in this model. I told you that you were trying to put too much into this one. That's not a leak," says the Lord. "It's a tear." The angel was impressed. "I created the woman," the Lord said. "She made the tear." Whether mom or dad or a favorite aunt or uncle, big brother or sister, raising a family today is still very challenging work. And it can be very precarious if you don't have a cornerstone to assure you that you are doing as a parent, guardian, or mentor what you're meant to do. Is Jesus Christ your cornerstone? The Bible teaches that Jesus is our good shepherd, and today mothers are like our good shepherds. They move us along. I know it's hard for mothers to work with kids. It's trying to, like, raising teenagers. It's a little bit like trying to nail jello to a tree. The best way to keep kids at home is to make a pleasant atmosphere once they turn 16. And if you don't want to let them out of the house, take the air out of their tires. Unfortunately, while growing old is mandatory, with our kids, growing up is optional. The good thing about growing older and being survivors of parenthood is this. You'll survive it. And the good thing about parenthood is this, that someday you're going to be able to eat dinner at 4 o'clock. Your secrets are safe with your friends because they can no longer remember them. And the last one, it's true. Right? This one's more true than any of them. Your joints are more accurate than the National Weather Service. Remembering where your cornerstone is may not be easy, and that's why time in worship like this is so important. I like the story of the family that had more than the average number of children, but they had a mother who got them all through it. Her name was Susanna Wesley, mother of Samuel, father of John Wesley. Samuel was a scholarly priest. Charles wrote 5,000 hymns. John's name and method of discipline would be given to a new church denomination. We're proud to be United Methodists. And today, in this facility, there's a cornerstone that means this building's going to stand with great trustees. But it's only the Church of Jesus Christ when you're here. Pastor Greg comes. He's going to be an energized entity of this building, new to you. Fresh ideas, ready to mobilize you for the kingdom of God. And I know that you're going to be ready because you have a cornerstone that represents the Church of Jesus Christ within your heart. Within your heart. Amen. As we close our time together, we sing together now the hymn that really binds all of us together. Blessed be the tie that binds. Everyone is also invited to the fellowship hall after church today. Peace. Together we say shalom.
Shalom. Shalom.